Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. This is Quantum Unicorn. If this is your first time tuning into my program, I want to let you know that all the demos and data files in my program are free to download. You can find these files by clicking the link below the video. And if you are a returning viewer, I hope you have taken my advice and spent some time practicing the code we covered in our last episode. And just a kind reminder, this course is meant for educational purposes only, and the data and information presented in this video is not investment advice, okay? And please subscribe to my channel, like the video, and click the bell icon on to receive the latest updates. Thank you. Well, today we are going to delve into the topic of how to estimate the average return utilizing confidence intervals. A confidence interval is a range of values within which we are reasonably sure that the true value of a population parameter lies. It is calculated from the sample data, and the width of the interval depends on the level of confidence and the sample size. For example, suppose we want to estimate the average height of students in a school. We first take a random sample of 50 students and find that their average height is, say, 160 centimeters, with a standard deviation of 5 centimeters. And we can then use this information to calculate a confidence interval for the true average height of all students in the school. Let's say we want a 95% confidence interval. We can use this formula to calculate the interval. And specifically, Z is the Z-score corresponding to the desired confidence level. In this case, the Z-score for 95% confidence level is 1.96. You can find this value in a Z table or use the non-PPF function in Python. So the 95% confidence interval is between 158.61 and 161.39. This means that we are 95% confident that the true average height of all students in the school is between 158.61 centimeter and 161.39 centimeter. Here is the Python code to calculate the confidence interval. So in finance, analysts use confidence interval to estimate the possible range of outcomes for a given data set. For example, a financial analyst might use the confidence interval to estimate the possible range of returns for a particular investment. The confidence interval provides a measure of the level of uncertainty associated with the estimate, which can be used to make informed decisions about the investment. A wider confidence interval indicates more uncertainty, while a narrower confidence interval indicates more confidence in the estimate. Here is a simple log return of Microsoft stock price from which we can compute the sample mean, which is an estimate of the true population mean. So our goal in this video is to go beyond mere estimation. It is reasonable to assume that if a sample is a good representation of the population mean should be in proximity to the sample mean. Thus, our task in this video is to determine the population mean by means of a range with a lower and upper bound. To commence with, we need to standardize the sample mean since different samples possess distinct means and standard deviations. we can standardize the sample mean by subtracting the population mean and dividing by the standard deviation of the population, which is equivalent to the sample size square root. After standardization, it follows a standard normal distribution, also known as the Z distribution. The Z distribution is a probability distribution that has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. It is a bell-shaped curve that is symmetric around the mean, with most of the data falling within 3 standard deviations of the mean. The distribution is important in statistics and probability because it allows us to standardize data and compare it to other distributions. By converting data to z-scores, we can calculate probabilities and make comparisons with different data sets. In finance, the z-distribution is often used in hypothesis testing to determine whether a given result is statistically significant. For example, a financial analyst might use the z-distribution to test whether a particular investment strategy is outperforming the market. By comparing the results to the z-distribution, the analyst can determine whether the results are statistically significant or whether they could have occurred by chance. This can help to guide investment decisions and avoid costly mistakes. In Python, we can use the SciPyStats module to work with the z-distribution. Here is an example of how to generate a random sample of 100 values from a standard normal distribution. This code uses the NumPy random normal function to generate a random sample of 100 values from a standard normal distribution. We can also calculate the z-score of a specific value by dividing standard deviation into the difference of value and mean. In this case, we calculate the z-score of a value of 1.5. And finally, we can use the statnorm CDF function to calculate the probability of a z-score being less than a certain value. Okay? Now you have a good understanding of both confidence interval and z-distribution. Now I'm going to show you the standard steps to calculate confidence interval using the z-distribution. First, we need to determine the confidence level we want to use. For example, if you want to calculate an 80% confidence interval, your confidence level would be 0.8, right? Then we need to look up the Z value that corresponds to our desired confidence level using a Z table. And with the help of Python, we can calculate the Z value with this formula, and the result is 1.28. And thirdly, we shall calculate the sample mean and sample standard deviation for the data set we are analyzing. And then we will calculate the standard error, which is equal to the sample standard deviation divided by the square root of the sample size. Then we multiply the standard error by the Z value, which we calculated before. And lastly, we add and subtract the value obtained in the last step from the sample mean to get the lower and upper bounds of the confidence interval, respectively. Here is an example Python code that calculates an 80% confidence interval using the z-distribution. In this example, the confidence interval for the data set is between 2.21 and 3.63 with an 80% confidence level. This means that we can be 80% confident that the true population mean falls within this range. Okay, now let's put what we just learned into constructing the 80% confidence interval for the daily return of Microsoft stock. First, we need to find the quantiles of the mean distribution. Then we can utilize the norm PPF function to obtain the quantiles. We can then compute the sample mean and the standard deviation of the sample, in which the population standard deviation is replaced by the sample standard deviation. If we run the cell, we can read the result of the 80% confidence interval. As you can see, it is noteworthy that this interval is on the positive side, and this indicates that the average return of the average daily return of Microsoft stock is highly likely to be positive. Overall, confidence intervals and the Z distribution are essential tools for financial analysts who need to make data-driven decisions based on statistical significance. By understanding these concepts and applying them to real-world scenarios, analysts can make more informed decisions and improve their performance. All right, that concludes our content for today. I really hope you guys got the hang of it. If you are feeling confused or frustrated about any of the code we showed in the program, please don't stress. I will go over the ins and outs of every line of code in the next episode, so we will get you up to speed in no time. And if any of the financial theories or statistical concepts we talked about are still a bit of mystery to you, just drop me a comment. I'm more than happy to give you some extra context or examples to help you out. And speaking of comments, I'm always open to your feedback and suggestions. So if you have got any thoughts on how we can make this program even better, please don't be shy about sharing them. Oh, and if you haven't already, I would love it if you could subscribe to my channel to stay updated to on my latest videos. And if you have friends or family who would also appreciate the knowledge of building stock trading models in Python, please feel free to share my video with them. I truly appreciate your support, and I'm excited to continue sharing more tutorials with you on my channel. Thank you again for your time, and I look forward to catching you all in the next episode. Goodbye.